Craig Foss.
Speaker, I move that the House take note of the report of the Finance and Expenditure Committee on the Budget Policy Statement 2010 and the Half-Year Economic and Fiscal Update 2009. Mr Speaker, I'd first of all like to thank the members of the Finance and Expenditure Committee for their hard work and their contributions in putting not only this report together, but also many other the high workload that we get through on the committee, making it happen very well. Also, Mr Speaker, I'd like to mention and acknowledge the officials that assist us and sometimes make us look a bit better than perhaps sometimes we are. Mr Speaker, the Budget Policy Statement confirmed that the Government's focus in 2010 will be about getting the economy growing again and ensuring that this growth is higher, more sustainable than we've seen in recent years, particularly the period 2005 to 2008, Mr Speaker, which I'll come back to. Mr Speaker, as noted in the report from FEC, the Prime Minister's statement to Parliament outlined and set the framework for some significant changes and developments in economic and social policies that will be seen in Budget 2010. But let's just stand up and stand back for a minute, Mr Speaker, and note that we need to achieve not only what this Government wants to achieve, but what New Zealand must achieve, what it has to achieve, if we're to anything like deliver on some of the expectations we should all have of a modern economy, Mr Speaker. And our focus is lifting on the long-term growth potential of the New Zealand economy without compromising short-term objectives and those desirables that we as a modern society choose to do to look after those that can't look after themselves, but, Mr Speaker, to put responsibility, accountability, transparency back into our economy and into our structure. Mr Speaker, we face a challenging, very challenging fiscal position. And yes, it's true that 10 years of deficits is no longer in front of us, Mr Speaker, but we still now have 6 to 7 years of deficits right in front of us with a very tenuous international environment indeed, Mr Speaker. And so this drives the demands that we show discipline in our accounts and have to do some realignment and perhaps make some of the hard decisions which have been surely lacking by the previous administration in the last few years, Mr Speaker. Mr Speaker, we do have choices though. Even some in this House may say do nothing or even go backwards. But if we go backwards, if we do nothing, actually we'll keep getting what we've got, Mr Speaker. And we had thousands upon thousands of our future taxpayers, our family, our friend, our whānau, leaving this country for a brighter economic future. Mr Speaker, we have to address that. We have to change. So let's get more ambitious for New Zealand, Mr Speaker. Let's set our sights higher and create a country which we can be even more proud of, where the hard-working Kiwis, so often referred to by speakers in this House, get ahead, get rewarded for their hard work, and, Mr Speaker, perhaps we can attract our children back home, Mr Speaker. So how do we do that? How can we do that, Mr Speaker? And we must create jobs, we must raise incomes, we must improve living standards, and we must provide better public services, at least, to our most vulnerable. I don't think many members in the House would disagree with that, Mr Speaker. Perhaps some will disagree with, in fact, how we're going to get there. But we have to change our economy. Most members in this House acknowledge that we have a consumption-led economy, borrow and hope, borrow against the increase in the value of the house, borrow and hope, borrow and consume, Mr Speaker. That's not the way to develop a country. That's not the way to move up the OECD ladders, Mr Speaker. That's not the way to keep our children in New Zealand when they after their tertiary education, Mr Speaker. We have to build up our financial assets in this country. We have to at least make a level playing field in those investment decisions between bricks and mortar and equities or financial decisions, Mr Speaker, which have been surely lacking over recent years. And I will note, Mr Speaker, that many of the imbalances in this economy actually began in 1999, at least, Mr Speaker, when the previous administration massively incentivised people to build up trust structures, company structures, and in some words, in fact, effectively encouraging a rorting of the tax base, Mr Speaker, which is totally unacceptable to me and which is totally unacceptable to our future taxpayers and our children. What will be in the budget, Mr Speaker? We'll be concentrating on 6 key drivers. One, investing in productive infrastructure. Two, removing red tape and improving regulation. Three, supporting business innovation and trade. Four, improving education and skills. 5, lifting productivity and improving services in the public sector. And 6, strengthening the tax system. Mr Speaker, we'll also put the disciplines on the Crown account, something that hasn't been seen for many, many years. We will be staying. We intend to stay within a $1.1 billion operating allowance year upon year. That is quite a change, Mr Speaker, but it's forced upon us for the state of the financial accounts because it was $2.8 billion, Mr Speaker, in the previous outgoing administration. $2.8 billion extra spending, Mr Speaker, which actually is now translating to an extra $3 billion a year that has to be borrowed currently to fulfil some of the programs the previous administration put in place, Mr Speaker. But I want to note, Mr Speaker, in the FEC's report to the House, page 6 at least, Mr Speaker, when we talk about the committee report, talks about those 6 key drivers. I'm fascinated and amazed, in fact, that the opposition and the Green Party members felt strong enough and did not believe in those 6 key drivers to a good economy, that they believe that evidence to link the government's 6 policy pillars and its growth targets is unclear and tentative at best. So that means members opposite do not believe that productive infrastructure, removing red tape, supporting business innovation, improving education, lifting productivity and strengthening and making fair our tax system contributes to a better economy. I look forward to other speakers from the opposition trying to justify that statement right there on page 6, Mr Speaker. Mr Speaker, also as part of FEC's report there, we combined it with a review at least of the half-year fiscal update, Mr Speaker. Now, I think most members acknowledge that the risks remain to our economy, to the global economy, but yes, things have got quite a bit better than they were in the deep, dark times of these global financial crisis earlier on, Mr Speaker, but tentative at the least. And one thing which I did note yesterday, and I'll repeat again today, the fact that the forecast accounts are looking a bit better doesn't mean they're fixed. They are just looking a bit better, which demands you keep the discipline on your spending caps, which demand you keep a focus on raising productivity, which demands you bring fairness and equity back into your system. Because if you don't, Mr Speaker, all those forecast curves will start to go the wrong way again. New Zealand's credit rating will be downgraded, our currency will fall through the floor, and our expectations of a modern economy will not be delivered, full stop, Mr Speaker. I do note, Mr Speaker, in the accounts that unemployment has hit a 10-year high of 7.3%. That is terrible, Mr Speaker. Many families have suffered for that. The only bright side of that, and the only bright side of that, Mr Speaker, is those forecasts, or at least what it's reached, are a lot lower than what was forecast earlier on, as recently as the middle of last year, Mr Speaker. But we must note, to get to this point, to even keep the lights on, to pay super, to pay education, to pay for health, to pay for law and order, to pay for the insulation packages, Mr Speaker, we are still, as a country, borrowing $240 million a week. $240 million a week are still being borrowed, Mr Speaker, just to keep the lights on. That is entirely why we need to concentrate on those 6 pillars, Mr Speaker, and bring some fairness and some ongoing growth back to our economy. Mr Speaker, I'd like to touch quickly on what the opposition has offered up as solutions, as their alternative budget. Well, the Leader of the Opposition over Christmas announced that he'd cap 16 public servant salaries. Mr Speaker, the government's budget's something like $65 billion, and the Leader of the Opposition had about 8 weeks to come up with that one. 16 public servant salaries was his answer to our issues, Mr Speaker. Their other solution is to borrow about $7 billion, because their spending increase promises that they announced day after day are now announced to amount to about $7 billion. We're borrowing $240 million right now, Mr Speaker. That's another $7 billion per annum. Mr Speaker, if you listen to what they're saying in some of their blog alerts, actually, they in fact want to increase taxes. Well, I guess old habits die hard, Mr Speaker, and remembering the first thing the Labor government did in 1999 in regard to tax when they come in is increase it from 33 to 39, create so many of the problems we have now. Their other solution, Mr Speaker, is a bus tour. A bus tour going around the country telling everybody that GST should not be increased from 12.5 to 15. Well, actually, Mr Speaker, it's half the story if in fact it was to be increased, because they constantly do not address, and I'd love other speakers to say this, when they increased it, when they were in, from 10 to 12.5%, what compensation did they provide to the New Zealand, hard-working New Zealand taxpayers, Mr Speaker. What compensation did they provide to super annuitants, to those on some kind of assistance at that time? The answer, Mr Speaker, is absolutely none. Mr Speaker, solutions will be coming in this budget. It's about fairness, equity, ongoing growth and sustainability for our country. Mr Speaker, I look forward to this budget 20th of May 2010.